Hello, and welcome to the history of Rome. It had been 200 years since the founding of Rome, and since that time the Romans had undergone a massive transformation. In the beginning, they were a collection of pastoral herdsmen and unsavory cast-offs making their way in the world by flock and trade, and since that time they had learned to become settled farmers, tilling the land and raising crops. They had gone from being a collection of armed rabble to a society of laws with a well-equipped, well-disciplined army. They had gone from upstart village to regional capital and now stood ready to challenge a wider pool of neighbors for control of all Italy. The Etruscans lay to the north and the Greeks to the south, and having conquered the central lowlands during the reign of the kings, the Romans now turned to the hills and mountains of East Italy for fresh conquests and, as always, were forced to parry the thrust of the Etruscan cities to the north. This is the world into which the Republic was born. According to the legendary chronology, the kings were overthrown in 509 BC, though the date is highly suspect. Most likely later, patriotic Roman historians changed the timing of the event to slightly predate the establishment of democracy in Athens by Cleisthenes in 508 BC. The Romans had a hard time believing they were not first and best in everything, especially in the democracy they took so much pride in, so they altered their history to outdo the Greeks. However, without any concrete data, it is hard to know exactly when the kings were driven out, so we are forced to mark our own histories of the city with the 509 date. As I said in part 1, the sack of Rome by the Gauls in 389 BC destroyed all primary documentation, so we are left with a mixture of legend and historical fiction. Before we get into the story of the early Republic, I want to pause for a moment and establish who exactly we are talking about here. I often say that Rome did this and that the Romans did that, but except for a few passing disambiguations, I have not done much to describe the varying nature of the population. Were they some homogeneous hive mind who agreed on everything and acted with a single will? No, quite the opposite. There were rich Romans and poor Romans and middle-class Romans. There were men and women and children. There were slaves and freed slaves and immigrants and criminals and honest men who worked hard every day and lazy men who did not. There were prostitutes and vestal virgins, and intellectuals and illiterates. Just like any society, the city of Rome was inhabited by a vast array of individuals, each with their own worldview, motivation, and dream. And just like in any society, the Romans did not always get along with one another, and, in fact, often fought bitterly with one another for control and freedom from control. When the Republic was founded, the population of Rome was around 130,000. This population was divided into two basic groups, the patricians and the plebs. Put simply, the patricians came from those families who could trace their roots back to the original 100 senators chosen by Romulus, and the plebs came from those that could not. Generally speaking, the distinction between patrician and plebe also followed economic class divisions, though, as we will see, it was never that simple. In the early days, the political weight of the classes was inversely related to their numerical size. The smaller set of patricians held power over the larger set of plebs. As I noted last week, the two richest classes in Rome held between them enough votes to snuff out any possible opposition, and those classes were, for the most part, made up of patricians, so the patricians made the rules. In the beginning, then, the democratic republic was really an oligarchy of wealthy, aristocratic families who shaped policy to serve their interests and who had no intention of ever letting anyone else into the decision-making process. I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but let me just say that it did not take long for the plebs, especially those plebs who were wealthy, to demand a greater voice in government. This tension between the patricians and the plebs would dominate Roman politics for the duration of the empire. Outside the basic patrician-plebe dichotomy, there were those without even nominal political standing, namely women, slaves, and immigrants. These groups formed a majority in sheer numerical terms, but were denied almost all political rights. Even the plebeian males, who howled righteously at the injustice of being denied a say in government, would have cried just as loud if someone had suggested suffrage being extended to women, or slaves, or immigrants. The idea would have been beyond comprehension. And the contradictions of the early Republic bear a striking resemblance to the contradictions of the early United States. When you picture the burgeoning Roman Republic, picture what you know of the burgeoning American Republic. The United States, though rhetorically cloaked in the language of freedom and equality, allowed only white, landowning males to vote. Eventually, the propertyless men agitated against the injustice of an oligarchical elite trampling on their freedoms and earned the same right, but women and blacks and Indians and the new immigrants were left out in the cold, present but unheard. This was Rome, a republic in which the disenfranchised majority were ruled by a disproportionately powerful elite. This, then, was the basic political breakdown of the population. Economically speaking, whether patrician or plebe, the majority of Romans were, by this time, settled farmers. But this was no utopia of land-owning citizen farmers. The land was owned by an elite minority and worked by the rest of the population. Economics and politics coincided just as they do today, and the tension between owner and operator mirrored the tension between patrician and plebe. Plebes were constantly agitating for land redistribution, and patricians blocked reform whenever they could. In this early stage of the empire, the actual work of the farms was still done by the lower-class citizens, slaves being an important part of the Roman economic model, but not yet the keystone upon which the entire system was based. The farms produced two basic products: food for internal consumption, usually grain and cereals, and crops for external trade, usually olives and grapes, and the refined offspring, oil and wine. The Romans, building on the roots already established by the Etruscans, used savvy trade policies to enrich themselves with all manner of foreign goods, establishing a truly international flavor in the city. But as in so many other aspects of Roman society, it was the wealthy patricians who controlled the import-export boards, and it was they who benefited the most from foreign trade. Needless to say, the landless plebe who worked in the fields did not dress in African finery and eat off of Greek silverware. Divisions were many within the population, economically and politically, and hatred abounded between the classes. But, in the end, they were all Romans, and set aside their differences any time the city was threatened, though picking up their rivalries right where they left off, when danger had passed. That all being said, it's time to continue with our story. And the tyranny of the monarchy had been banished forever. It was decided, and again, when you picture this, feel free to picture the patrician senators and equites hammering out the details, because it was really them making all the early decisions. The lower classes and plebes had nothing to do with it. The two men should rule annually to avoid any single man accumulating too much power. Originally, these men were called praetors, though the title would be changed in the early 300s BC to the more familiar consul. For clarity's sake, I will use the latter designation even for the early executives who were technically praetors, because the office itself did not change, just the name, and, well, most translations of early Roman history refer to them as consuls anyway, so there is no reason to confuse an already confusing situation with a lot of semantic nitpicking. Anyway, to the Roman mind, ensuring freedom was not so much a matter of scaling back or limiting the power of the executive, as the founding fathers sought to do with their system of checks and balances, as it was a matter of limiting the length of time within which absolute rule could be wielded. The consuls had all the same powers a king had, near absolute power over war and peace, life and death. They just had to give it up after a year. The second consul was the one check the Romans did add into the system. One consul could veto the actions of the other, and that was that. Any consul who tried to run away with power could be stopped at a word from his colleague. If the two conspired to oppress the people, their terms of office expired after a year, and they were back to being mere citizens, with all the legal weight that would be brought down upon two men who sought to make themselves king. In the end, it was the expiring term of office that really let the Romans sleep well at night. The executive power sharing was merely a useful novelty. In that year, 509 BC, this was as far as the Republic had gone constitutionally. Rather than the comitia centuriata getting together and electing a king who served for life, they got together and elected two men who served for 1 year. As I said last week, the first two consuls were Lucius Junius Brutus and Lucius Tarquinius Collatinus. The former led the revolt against the king, and the latter's raped wife had sparked the event. Brutus's first act was to make all men swear an oath that they should never again allow a king to rule Rome. As you can see, the legacy of Numa remained a potent force. Brutus felt that a sacred oath before Jupiter would be enough to bind men to oppose monarchy, and, barring a few exceptions, it did. The Romans did not mess around with their oaths. There was, however, an immediate problem. Collatinus, you will note, bore the hated moniker Tarquinius, being a relative of the overthrown king. The population, jittery in their newfound freedom, worried that lust for power was an inborn trait of the Tarquins, and immediately regretted their election of Collatinus, despite the fact that he had helped lead the revolution and vocally denounced his cousins. When pressed, though, Collatinus agreed, for the sake of the stability and viability of the new republic, to resign the consulship, even though everyone agreed it was completely ridiculous to ask him to do so. In his place, another one of the ringleaders of the revolt was elected, Publius Valerius, who will, in a moment, earned the honorarium Publicola, or Friend of the People, for his service to Rome. Students of American history will immediately recognize Publius's name. The Federalist Papers, written by James Madison, Alexander Hamilton, and John Jay, in defense of the newly written Constitution, appeared in print under the pseudonym Publius in honor of this consul's role in securing Rome's new republic. Publius is often cited as being one of the original consuls of Rome, but we should not forget Collatinus and his selfless resignation in the face of baseless and superficial fears for the sake of his country's freedom. The first threat the new republic faced was the first threat all successful revolutions face, namely, counter-revolution. There were more than a few Romans who had lived just fine under the kings and were in no mood to lose their privileged place in society. A collection of young nobles, including two sons of the consul Brutus, conspired with envoys of the exiled King Tarquin to betray the city to him and reinstate the monarchy. The plot was revealed by one of the noble slaves, and the entire group was arrested. Brutus was shocked to see his own sons involved in the affair, but incontrovertible evidence was produced confirming their guilt. The penalty for treason was severe, and despite his tortured misgivings, Brutus would not stop the sentence from being carried out. The young conspirators were tied to a post, scourged, and then beheaded. Brutus's decision was long lauded by the Romans as a patriotic sacrifice, teaching a moral lesson about putting the welfare of the state before even one's own family, but the ruthlessness of the decision often makes it difficult for us to see the nobility of the act. The second threat the new republic faced was the second threat all successful revolutions face, namely, invasion by an opportunistic enemy trying to take advantage of a neophyte central government. Tarquin had by this time taken refuge in Veii and pleaded with the nobility there to aid him in reconquering Rome. He argued that the virus of republicanism might infect Etruria and wipe out all the royal families in the region. The nobles of Veii were indeed worried about their subjects catching the freedom bug and, believing that Rome's leadership would be shaky and disjointed without a strong king in charge, agreed to aid Tarquin and attacked. However, to the surprise and consternation of Tarquin and the Veiites, Brutus and Publius proved to be extremely capable commanders, routing the army from Veii easily. The battle was not without tragedy for the Romans, though. In the middle of the fight, Brutus, liberator of Rome, was killed. His body was borne back to the city, and Rome went into mourning for a full year. Publius now stood alone and, like Collatinus before him, soon fell under suspicion by the fickle and paranoid masses. After the battle with the Veiites, Publius began construction on a home atop the Velia, a ridge jutting from the north side of the Palatine Hill. The people suspected him of making a fortress from which he could safely enslave them all. Publius caught wind of the sentiment and called a mass meeting, shaming the populace for their irrational fears and announcing that if it worried them so much, he would move his home to the bottom of the hill, where they could all keep watch on him. He further used the opportunity provided by the meeting to propose two new laws, which made him a hero to the now assuaged masses and earned him the aforementioned title Publicola. The two laws are famous even to this day. The first stated that any man who tried to make himself king could be killed at any time by any other man without fear of reprisal. And the second stated that any decision by the magistrates could be appealed to the people's assemblies. Publius, content with the single credit he received for these democratic initiatives, then called for an election to fill the open consulship. Marcus Horatius Pulvius was eventually elected after a short detour through a consul who was elected but then died from old age a few days later. And this closed the first year of the Republic. Leadership settled, the people mollified, and Rome secure. In the coming years, the tension between patrician and plebe would dominate public life in Rome. The patricians wary always of runaway mob rule, and the plebes seeing no practical difference between the overthrown king and the newly empowered Senate. Next week, we will jump headlong into this so-called conflict of the orders and witness the plebes voting with their feet and demanding a real voice in the allegedly democratic republic they had all fought so hard to establish and keep. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Last week, We discussed the transitional year of 509 BC, when Rome went from being a typical Italian kingdom to an atypical Italian republic. Though the actual workings of the republic were not as democratic as they appeared on the surface, the fact remained that the monarchy had been abolished and annual elections now determined leadership. The first years after the change would prove difficult for the new government, for it faced both internal dissension and external invasion. Those years would see the final defeat of the Tarquins, the re-subduing of Latium, and finally the extension of political rights to the plebes with the creation of the office of tribune, the plebeian answer to the patrician consulship. After his Viet army was defeated, the ex-king Tarquin next took refuge in the Etruscan city of Clusium under the protection of its king, Lars Porsena. Tarquin begged Porsena to attack the Romans, repeating his line about the threat democracy posed to royalty everywhere and the necessity of returning a king to the throne. Porsena, like the Viets, no doubt took this argument under advisement, but when he agreed to make war with the Romans, he did so ultimately for his own reasons. There are two accounts of what happened next. Either Porsena invaded and was successfully repulsed, or he invaded and captured the city. The former is alleged by Roman folktales, the latter is supported by modern historical analysis. According to the legendary tradition, Porsena, in defense of his fellow Etruscan king Tarquin, marched south and was met by the Roman forces at the Tiber. The Romans, seeing the size of the Etruscan army, fled back across the river, leaving the bridge, and therefore the city, unguarded. A single Roman soldier named Horatius, realizing he could not prevent the army's flight, ordered men to set fire to the bridge in order to prevent the Etruscans from crossing and sacking the city. To buy time, he stood alone on the far side of the bridge and challenged the whole of Porsena's army to combat. While the dumbstruck Etruscans tried to figure out what they should do with this crazy, brave, but clearly suicidal soldier, the other Romans set fire to the wooden bridge. The Etruscans were finally snapped out of their stupor when the burning bridge collapsed into the river and attacked, but Horatius jumped in the river and swam unscathed to the other side, saving the city and enrolling himself in the pantheon of great Roman heroes. Porsena was forced to initiate a siege, which proved no more effective than his initial assault, again due to the bravery of a single Roman citizen. This time it was Mucius Scaevola, who proved his valor and secured ultimate victory for Rome. The city was suffering under Porsena's siege and showed no signs of being able to fight it off. Mucius, taking matters into his own hand, crossed over to the Etruscan camp. He made his way to Porsena's headquarters and waited for an opportunity to strike. When Porsena's entourage emerged, Mucius attempted to assassinate the king, but, unsure of who his target was, mistakenly attacked one of the king's secretaries. Mucius was seized and dragged before the shaken king. What happened next would be the stuff of Roman legend and a moral story to inspire generation upon generation of future citizens. Mucius told the king that the Romans had declared war not on the men of Clusium, but upon Porsena personally, and that he was merely the first in a long line of assassins who would not stop until the king was dead. The king, unnerved by this idea, ordered Mucius burned alive and found himself only further unnerved by what Mucius did next. The Roman stuck his right hand into the fire and, without flinching, allowed it to burn. He declared that such was the regard Roman men held for their bodies and that the king should remember what lay in store for him. Porsena was, to say the least, impressed and very freaked out. He allowed Mucius to go free, commending the man for his bravery, and not wishing to live his life under a death sentence from a bunch of psychotic patriot assassins, he made peace with Rome and lifted the siege, never having taken the city. This was the official legend. Other, non-Roman sources tell a different, more plausible story. In this version, Porsena did indeed take Rome in the turbulent years after the founding of the Republic and set up a puppet government. The outcome seems reasonable in that the Etruscans of Clusium would have been much stronger and far better equipped than the Romans were at this point, and resistance would have been futile at best. The reason Porsena, who is a confirmed historical figure, invaded Rome is a further divide between fact and legend. The melodrama of Tarquin's plea for Etruscan solidarity is pure fiction, as is the decisiveness of individual Roman bravery. Population upheaval in Italy around 500 BC had resulted in an estrangement between Etruria and their Greek trading partners in the south. Specifically, Etruscan trade routes were disrupted by the Volscians, a central Italian hill tribe who settled the plains between Etruria and Magna Graecia south of Rome. Porsena's conquest of the Romans was just a step in the greater project of maintaining the safety of the southern trade roads from attack. Disabusing the notion that the war had been waged on Tarquin's behalf, Porsena left his son in charge of matters in Latium after defeating Rome. His son, though, was defeated by an army of allied Latins and driven back north, re-securing independence for Rome as an unintended byproduct. The Latin communities emerged strong from the encounter, and Rome humbled, setting up a major confrontation for control of central Italy that would ultimately see Rome re-emerge as the dominant force in Latium for another 150 years. The Latins had chafed under Roman rule during the reign of the Tarquins, and took the opportunity presented by Rome's weakened position to attempt a redrawing of the political landscape. Disorganized by Porsena's invasion and a lack of internal political unity, Rome seemed easy pickings for the emboldened Latins. But they underestimated Rome's will, a common mistake made by enemies of the empire for years to come. An alliance of Latin communities broke from the Romans and forced the issue into an armed conflict, which they thought would see them master Rome, but instead it led them right back under the yoke. A decisive battle was fought near Lake Regillus, southeast of Rome, and though the details of the fight are unimportant, the Battle of Lake Regillus is important for two reasons. First, as I mentioned, it ended Latin resistance to Rome for another 150 years, until, embroiled in a long war with the Samnites, Rome was again seen as vulnerable enough to resist. Second, it marked the first time that a dictator led a Roman army in battle. The office of dictator was a curious instrument to find within the constitution of a republic, but the Romans felt that extraordinary emergencies called for extraordinary solutions, and dictators were appointed periodically over the years when such emergencies arose. Basically, a dictator was appointed when all the red tape needed to be cut through, and one single man needed to take decisive action now, without complaint or appeal or challenge. According to law, a dictator could be appointed for 1 6-month term, at the end of which he would resign and power would revert back to the consuls. At the beginning of his term, the dictator appointed a vice dictator, called his master of horse, who was accountable to no one but the dictator himself. The Romans were sufficiently distressed by the hostility of the Latins that they used their extraordinary solution for the first time to lead an army against a foreign threat. And technically the first dictator ever appointed had been a man named Titus Larius, who had served briefly in that position 2 years before to quell internal riots, but beyond trivia, the event is hardly worth mentioning. The appointment of a Lucius Postumius, however, was a watershed moment. Larius's appointment had been a ploy used by the patricians to put the fear of God back into the plebes, which of course it did, but there was never any question of actually instilling him with dictatorial powers for any period of time. Postumius, however, was given the keys to the city and told to do whatever was necessary to defeat the Latins, essentially that he was now a law unto himself. Postumius did indeed lead the army to victory over the Latins, and then, in a remarkable display of constitutional loyalty, stepped down from the heady heights of absolute dictatorship and restored the consuls to their rightful positions. The remarkable giving up of power demonstrates both Postumius's personal honor and the extent to which Rome as a whole probably would have cried out for his murder if he had considered remaining in power. The monarchy really was dead, and though dictators would be appointed off and on for the next 450 years, it was not until Julius Caesar that a dictator did not ultimately resign of his own free will. The Latins reconquered and the dictatorship passed, Rome found itself at peace. And as a general rule, whenever Rome found itself at peace abroad, it immediately found itself divided at home. The question of plebeian rights, never satisfactorily settled, now reared its head once again. The plebes were not to be put off this time. No amount of patrician chicanery and backroom dealing would break their solidarity. Only rights guaranteed by law would satisfy them now. The plebes would ultimately win political concessions from the patricians, though it took the first recorded strike in history to do so. Trouble arose over the matter of debt bonding. In Roman law at the time, if a debtor could not pay his creditor, then he became a bonded servant to the creditor until the debt was repaid. The system of indentured servitude essentially made permanent slaves of the debtors because, while servants to the creditors, they were unable to earn any money to pay off their debts. Many of the soldiers who fought in the recent war against the Latins found themselves bonded in this way. The practice in this case was especially egregious because the debts were incurred while the men were off fighting in patriotic defense of the city. The plebs agitated for debt relief, but were rebuffed by the patricians, whose attitude was basically, you take on the debt, you pay the price. Offended by this high-handed treatment, the plebs were on the verge of full-blown revolt when the city suddenly found itself under attack from all sides. The Sabines, Volscians, and Aquians all began making forays into Roman territory, and the Senate called for armies to be raised. The plebs sensed an opportunity, and when the consuls began calling names for enlistment, not one of them made a move. The Senate was basically beside itself with this mass act of treason and immediately appointed a dictator to smash the resistance. But in an amazing display of moderation and wisdom, they appointed the brother of Publius Publicola, Manlius Valerius, whom the plebs loved, to the office. Valerius begged the plebs to do their duty and enlist, promising that once hostilities were concluded, the issue of debt relief would be addressed straight away. Swayed by Valerius, they relented and legions were formed. In due course, all three foreign threats were put down and the legions returned to Rome. Back in the city, however, Valerius was unable to fulfill his promise. The patrician senators blocked his attempts at debt relief, and Valerius resigned his office, laying at the Senate's feet all domestic turmoil that would ensue as a result of their decision. The disbanded legionnaires were outraged at the betrayal and took an extraordinary step that would become known to history as the secession of the plebs. The soldiers marched en masse to the Sacred Mount, a hill 3 miles from Rome, and set up a fortified camp, refusing to return to the city until their demands were met. The population of the city flew into a panic. The remaining plebs feared retaliatory violence from the patricians, and conversely, the patricians feared runaway mob violence without the army around to maintain order. And what they both feared the most was external invasion. If word got out that Rome's army had abandoned her, every two-bit tribe in the neighborhood would come knocking on the city gates, and Rome would be at their mercy. So the Senate relented and sent an envoy to the plebe camp to broker a deal. The settlement did not address the debt question directly. Rather, a new office was created to shield the plebs from future patrician tyranny, the tribunate. The dangerous precedent set by the strike was pointed out to the plebs by the patrician envoy who compared the republic to a body. It is true, he told them, the hands and feet and mouth could join forces and stop working for the lazy stomach who sat there greedily receiving all the food the other parts worked for. But if they were to do so, the entire body would soon die of starvation, for the stomach pumped energy back out into the limbs. The plebs would be granted more rights to end the secession, the envoy said, but they must not think, in the future, that starving the stomach was in their enlightened best interest. The plebs took some note of this, but were so absorbed with their success that it is doubtful the lesson fully sank in. The role of tribune was defensive in nature. Two plebeian men would be elected each year to act as a counterweight to the consuls. Initially, the power of the tribunes was modestly held to the right to free any man from patrician imprisonment, though in the future they would gain the right to veto, literally, I forbid, any law passed by the consuls or the Senate at a word. The tribunes were also granted sacrosanctity, or the right to be free from harm. The plebs took a solemn oath to kill any man who attempted to assault a tribune, and more than once that oath was fulfilled. The tribunate would become a flashpoint for Roman politics for the remainder of the Republic. The eventual power to veto led to a number of showdowns with the patricians, both sides bloodying themselves in their attempts to control state policy. The power of the office would peak with the Gracchi brothers around 125 BC and fall into obsolescence with the ascension of the Caesars. But for the bulk of the Republican period, it was an important and powerful office. The tribunes would be elected by a new assembly called the Comita Tributa, which would be made up of the now 35 tribes of Rome. Suffrage in the assembly was not based on property assessment as it was with the Centuriata, and so the Comita Tributa was as democratic a form as Rome would ever see. The secession of the plebs occurred in 494 BC, about 15 years after the birth of the Republic. Though domestic combustion and foreign invasion were constant threats, the Republic had passed through its infancy and emerged as an adolescent power ready for fresh challenges. Any threat posed by the ex-king Tarquin was gone, and monarchy was now firmly in the rearview mirror. The attempted revolt by the Latin communities had been suppressed by a Republican army, and Rome managed to maintain control of Latium just as it had while a monarchy. The patricians and plebes were settled in an alliance, uneasy though it may have been, and the population was more or less at peace with itself. Next week we will cover the creation of the final piece of the Republican puzzle, the Law of the Twelve Tables, as well as discuss the rising threat posed by the Volscians, which caused the Romans to make their first concerted forays into the eastern hills, where they would fight the wars that would ultimately win them control of all Italy. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. We ended last week with the plebes finally being granted nominal political rights, or at least defenders within the political arena, with the creation of the office of tribune. This stopped plebeian agitation for a while, but as the years passed, a new generation came of age and demanded further protection from the ever-present threat of patrician tyranny. It was not enough to be protected from an abuse of the law, because, at the time, nobody knew exactly what the law was. The legal framework of Rome was a nebulous body of oral and written traditions, with precedents and subclauses hiding all over the place, in official decrees, letters, pronouncements, and, most dangerously, in the minds of old patrician lawyers. Who was to say a man was being treated unjustly if no one knew exactly what justice was? This new generation of plebeian agitators would ultimately win a great victory for themselves and the rule of law, giving the Romans a set of written precepts that would be memorized by every child and recited by every adult, the 12 tables of Roman law. This official codification of the law occurred around 451 BC, but before we get to that point in our story, I want to give a brief account of what Rome dealt with in the 40-odd years between the inception of the tribunate and the creation of the 12 tables. Internally, Rome was full of tension, but, as I said, for the first 20 years or so, nothing boiled over too much to disrupt the day-to-day, year-to-year operations of the city. The consuls and senate still held the lion's share of the power, though they were now checked somewhat by the tribunes. The Romans were held together by an unceasing series of wars against their neighbors to the north, east, and south. To the north, they fought a particularly hard campaign against their old nemesis, the Veites, that ended in a stalemate in 474 BC. A campaign that came complete with a dressed-up Battle of Thermopylae, with 306 members of the noble Fabii family cast in the role of King Leonidas and his doomed Spartans. Protecting an undefensible pass, the Fabii clan fought to the last man to give the legions a chance to regroup. The battles fought to the east and south were of a different sort and revolved around a geographically based cultural clash. Veii may have been in competition with Rome, but at least it was a settled city of civilized farmers. Out in the eastern hills, however, nomadic tribes, particularly the Volscians and the Aquians, pressed at Rome's borders. The nomadic herdsmen coveted Rome's soft, flat land and tried every year to carve out some or all of Roman territory and turn it from parceled farms into a massive grazing zone. As a result, the Romans were constantly beating back encroachment by the migrant tribes, who occasionally mustered enough force to give the Romans a run for their money, but were usually dispatched easily. For the first 10 years after the secession of the plebes, and running concurrently with the on-again, off-again battles with Veii, the Volscians posed the greatest danger. They had already made great inroads south of the city, effectively securing all the land between the hills and the sea, blocking trade with Magna Graecia. The peak of the Volscian threat came early, in 491 BC, when a disgruntled Roman general named Coriolanus defected and led a Volscian army through the legions and right to the gates of the city. The Roman men beaten, the women were sent to plead with Coriolanus to end his attack, and it was only after a personal appeal from his own mother that Coriolanus' heart finally turned and he withdrew the army. His Volscian officers were appalled at being denied their easy victory, and back in Volscian territory, they murdered their Roman leader. It has been noted that the story of Coriolanus bears a striking resemblance to the story of the great Athenian general Themistocles, and that the story was probably inserted later to account for the defeat suffered by Rome at the hands of nomadic rabble. The Roman ego demanded that Romans could only be defeated by other Romans. By the mid-480s BC, though, the Volscian threat had largely been contained, and the city was never seriously threatened again, though the Volscians maintained control over the southern plains for the remainder of the century and were a constant menace along Rome's borders. Throughout the 470s and 460s BC, even though the external danger had been greatly diminished, the legions still went out every summer campaigning against the latest forays by the Volscians or Aquian raiders. The total military dominance of Rome over the hill tribes eventually led the plebe leaders to suspect that the patricians were not being totally honest with the threat level posed by the tribes. And with the record the Roman army had, it's hard to blame them. Without even breaking a sweat, the legions dispatched every enemy they encountered. A political pattern began to emerge. Plebe leaders would decry the raising of yet another army to go do battle with the Volscians or whoever, even though they posed no serious threat, and would denounce the Senate for starting wars to put off questions of further economic and political reform. These leaders would always, in turn, be denounced by the Senate as self-absorbed traitors who were putting personal ambition ahead of Rome's safety. The plebe leaders would shoot back that the patricians were sending men out to die for no other reason than to tighten their grip on wealth and power. A standoff would ensue, but Rome, being what it was, would ultimately raise the legion and the plebeian demagogues would be silenced. The Romans were soldiers, and fighting is what they did. Throughout these years, Rome's position vis-a-vis the nomadic herdsmen was never seriously threatened, though in the following century, Rome would fight a knockdown, drag-out war with a rising hill tribe called the Samnites that would ultimately see all Italy eventually fighting on one side or the other. In the years after the secession of the plebes, there were essentially two major initiatives that excited the plebes and kept the patricians up at night. The first was proposed by a tribune named Valero in 473 BC. It stated simply that the tribunes ought to be elected by the tribal assembly and not by the comitia centuriata as they had been in the first years after the office was created. The patricians balked at the idea, knowing full well that they would no longer have undue weight in choosing who would be tribune. As I noted last week, the patricians inevitably failed in their attempt to quash the proposal. An election of the tribunes was duly passed to the comitia tributa. As if this wasn't bad enough, in 462 BC, a tribune named Tarantillus made an even more radical proposal. The laws of Rome should be written down and posted so that all citizens would be bound to the same codes and no man could rise above them. The patricians were horrified at the thought and spent the next 10 years doing everything in their power to stop its implementation. It was during these years that the plebs really started to resist military service and openly question patrician motives. At one point, however, caught up in their own rhetoric, they failed to believe it when the Senate woke up one morning and announced that during the night, a small Sabine army had penetrated the city and had taken the citadel. It was only after a desperate plea by the consuls that the plebs finally agreed to raise an army, finding much to their surprise that the citadel had in fact been taken and their city was under siege. The legions, along with a contingent of local allies, easily dislodged the Sabines, and the greatest casualty of the whole encounter was what little influence the tribunes had so recently achieved. The patricians, as a result, managed to put off Tarantillus's proposal for another 10 years. In the end, though, they were forced to relent. Political consciousness had been raised in the city by travelers from the south who brought with them word of Solon's political reforms in the great Greek city of Athens, causing proponents of reform to beat a steady drum. Finally, a combination of plague, famine, and the economically destabilizing introduction of coins as a medium of exchange in 454 BC led to a crisis of confidence in the leadership, and something had to be done to assuage the masses. It was agreed in 451 BC that consular power for the year would be transferred to a body of 10 men called the Decemvirate, whose main task it would be to collect and condense Roman law into a single uniform code to be published on bronze tablets in the Forum for all to see. Unfortunately, the total contents of the 12 tables, each posted on a separate bronze tablet, hence the name, have been lost to history, and all we have to rely on is occasional excerpts and summaries by later Roman authors. We know generally what topics each table covered, and the range and detail gives a fascinating insight into the Roman mind. Held within the tables, written 2,500 years ago, we find the basis for many of our own founding principles. For example, the ninth table explicitly forbids passage of laws against specific individuals, a principle still in force today, while the first table establishes the sanctity of the subpoena, or the requirement to appear before a court. The tables covered a wide range of matters, from lawsuit procedures, to payment of debts, to inheritance rights, to upkeep of public sewers, to divorce and property boundary issues. I will not bore you with a lengthy recitation of the contents of each table, but I do want to highlight some of the more curious facets of the Roman legal mind. For example, according to the 8th table, a thief caught at night may be killed without penalty, but if the same thief is caught during the day, he must be delivered unharmed to the magistrates. Contained within the same table, we discover what the penalty was for throwing an unaimed weapon into a crowd. The accused was fined 1 ram. The 7th table states that fruit that falls from a tree onto a neighbor's property shall be the property of that neighbor, a provision which demonstrates just how scrupulously litigious the Romans could be. Death was the ultimate penalty, and was prescribed for a number of crimes, including murder and the destruction of crops, but also, interestingly, for matters involving the integrity of the courts. Magistrates who took bribes to influence their decisions, as well as witnesses who lied under oath, were both ordered flung from a high cliff. To the Romans, perjury was a heinous crime that threatened the entire community. The final provision I want to point out was hidden deep in the 9th table, a piece of fine print that, once discovered, outraged the plebs and led to violent class confrontations. No patrician shall be allowed to marry a plebe. Effectively, this codified a closing off of upward social mobility to the majority of the population and guaranteed that none of them would ever hold the most powerful office of state, the consulship. This did not go over well with the plebs. As I mentioned earlier, the 12 tables were the foundation of later Roman law and were memorized by all citizens, literate or not. The existence of a written body of law was not a Roman innovation, nor did it make them unique in the ancient world, but it did put them into a select group of states that valued the objectivity of the law over the subjectivity of capricious rulers. The story of the decemvirs, the magistrates tasked with the compilation, ends with an interesting bit of legendary melodrama. During the year, or two depending on the source, that the decemvirs were in office, they held ultimate authority. The unbroken chain of consular elections had been broken, and effectively a new form of government had been briefly ushered in. Rather than rule by 2 men, it was rule by 10 men. And among those 10 men, one was first among equals, a man named Appius Claudius. Claudius came from a family of staunch patricians, and was a vigorous opponent of just about any proposed plebeian reform. After finishing their appointed task, the decemvirate had lost their raison d'etre and was set to disband, but Claudius, enjoying his newfound power, convinced his colleagues that they should remain in office after their term expired. The other decemvirs, similarly enjoying the trappings of power, agreed, and when the consular elections for that year arrived, the decemvirate simply did not allow anyone to stand, and no elections were held. The people found themselves unexpectedly in a constitutional crisis. Even though Claudius and the decemvirs had made a naked power grab, there was no legal avenue available to stop them, for the decemvirate had been instilled with all judicial authority. Ironically, the body of men who laid down the laws were the first to blatantly ignore them. Days and weeks passed with the decemvirate maintaining their illegal hold on power, until finally Claudius went too far and the entire city rose up in revolt. Claudius had his eye on a beautiful plebeian girl who was said to be married to a young army officer. Claudius declared out of the blue that the girl in question was an escaped slave owned by one of his clients and that she must be returned. A hearing was called to decide the case, and numerous witnesses were brought up, attesting to the freeborn status of the young woman. But the trial was overseen by Claudius, who, to the astonishment of everyone present, ruled that the girl was indeed an escaped slave and was the property of the complaining client, despite obvious evidence to the contrary. The people were appalled at this absurd conclusion, and the army, when it caught wind of the decision, joined in their outrage. The husband-to-be and the father of the woman were both officers in good standing, and the army was incredulous at the arbitrary injustice of Claudius towards one of their own. The people, supported by the army, then used their bargaining chip of last resort and abandoned the city, removing themselves to the sacred mount just as they had done 40 years earlier. The decemvirs, recognized that their position had become untenable, finally resigned. Claudius was arrested, but rather than face trial, he killed himself. Regular consular elections then took place, and Rome's domestic tranquility was restored. The plebeians actually emerged from the order better off than they had been, for in their negotiations to return to the city, they demanded the number of tribunes be raised to 10, which the Senate, anxious to get things back to normal and again fearing invasion, agreed to. And of course, the codification of the laws, the decades-long plebeian demand, had already been accomplished, leaving them in a much stronger position legally to fend off future patrician tyranny. The creation of the 12 tables left the plebes on the one hand overjoyed, but on the other they were horrified by some of the provisions it contained. True, the rule of law would now dominate patrician subjectivity, but that one sticking point of the illegality of patrician-plebe marriage opened their eyes to an oppression that they never knew existed. Only patricians could be consuls or hold the other high magistracies, including Pontifex Maximus. If no plebe could ever marry a patrician, then no plebe would ever hold high office, and the patricians would always and forever hold the winning political hand. The next cycle of patrician-plebe conflict would revolve around this very issue, eventually leading to a number of reforms that further diluted the patrician's stranglehold on power, which we will get to in the weeks ahead. Those of you who know Roman history may have noticed that I ran right by one of the most well-known folk legends, which occurred around 460 BC, without so much as a mention. That is because next week I want to focus in detail on the central figure of that story, the great Cincinnatus, whose career spans both sides of the Decemvirate interlude. Join me next week as we untangle the man from the myth and figure out what made Cincinnatus such a towering figure that American settlers felt compelled to name their new boomtown on the Ohio River after a Roman who had been dead 2,200 years. Last week in 451 BC with the 12 tables of law written down and the Decemvirate expelled. This week I want to step back a few years to focus on the life of one man, Lucius Quintius Cincinnatus, who was passed into the collective memory as a paradigm of Republican virtue, even though the decisive moments of his life were almost certainly invented by later historians to embellish his famous career, and, in the end, nothing he did was particularly unprecedented. Still, his biography continues to resonate, and taken by itself, it is a pretty good story of a humble man who had absolute power thrust upon him, and then, remarkably, relinquished that power and returned to his plow. A man who sacrificed everything for the Republic. Cincinnatus was born around 519 BC, when the king still reigned, and was just a boy when Brutus and Collatinus expelled the Tarquins. He was therefore one of the first citizens in Rome who lived his entire life under a republican government, without strong memories of the monarchy. He was in the vanguard of a critical generation. His elders remembered vividly the tyranny of Tarquin, and their steadfast republican principles reflect a personally developed hatred of monarchy. They were the victims and would do anything to avoid being victims again. Cincinnatus, however, and those of his generation, never personally experienced this victimization. Once they came of age, the Republic would have to sink or swim on its own merit. If a would-be tyrant began to acquire too much power, there would be no one to turn to and say, "Hey, remember Tarquin? This guy's trying to be another Tarquin," because there would be no one left who actually remembered Tarquin. It is in this passing from living memory that mistakes of history repeat themselves. Ambitious men of later generations might attempt to seize power, and, believing their times to be unique, a cowering population might allow it. In those times, only vigilance born of a love of republic, not a hatred of monarchy, would save the people from slavery, and Cincinnatus was amongst the first to set down that love of the republic for its own sake. To dispel one myth straight away, Cincinnatus was at no point a defender of the little guy. He was a patrician by birth and upbringing, and when he emerged on the public stage, it was as a steadfast opponent of the tribunes and their reforms. His first appearance in the historical record is not a starring role, but rather a supporting part in the drama of his son Caeso. There is a great deal of civil unrest in the aftermath of Tarantillus's proposal to codify the law, and plebe demonstrations in the forum were often broken up by collections, or gangs if you prefer, of young patrician nobles. Caeso, an abnormally large young man, took to this with great relish, personally beating and chasing any plebe who tried to take part in such demonstrations. Young and hot-tempered that he was, though, he was easy pickings for a savvy tribune named Virginius, who intentionally goaded Caeso by leading provocative public marches that would inevitably draw the wrath of the young man. Once he had enough witnesses and evidence, Virginius brought capital charges against Queso for, well, all the horrible things he had done. Queso was ordered to appear at a trial, and if he did not, then he would be fined a large sum of money. It is at this point that Cincinnatus makes his first appearance in the public record, defending his son against Virginius's accusations and asking that the charges be dropped. Rather than face an obviously hostile and biased court, Queso fled north to Etruria and out of the history of Rome completely. His son having essentially jumped bail, Cincinnatus was forced to sell most of his properties to pay the debt, leaving him a pauper with only a small plot of land on the far side of the Tiber. It is from this impoverished state that Cincinnatus's own legend begins. In 460 BC, not long after the Sabines had been expelled from the citadel, Cincinnatus was chosen to serve as one of the two consuls for that year. The tribunes were less than thrilled at this development, recognizing that they had just put the screws to this old man because they were angry with his son, and now he was in a position of authority over them. Cincinnatus did nothing to ease their minds, immediately attacking the character of the plebe leadership, who he accused of aiding and abetting the Sabine capture of the citadel with their selfish myopia. This set the tone for the year. Struggles ensued between the consuls on the one hand, the tribunes on the other, with the Senate and popular assemblies caught in between. Cincinnatus managed to kill Tarantillus's bill for the year, while the tribunes banned the consuls from taking any army more than 1 mile outside the city limits. By the end of the year, no compromise was reached, and the battle was set to continue on into the next year, but the Senate passed a law stating that no magistrate, patrician or plebe, could serve in successive years. The tribunes dismissed this out of hand and had themselves re-elected, so the patricians were set to reconfirm Cincinnatus when he announced that if they were to act no better than the plebes, then they were no better than the plebes, and refused to stand for office. Agreeing reluctantly to this logic, the patricians allowed Cincinnatus to retire to his small farm. It would not be long, however, before he was called back to service in his most famous role, dictator of Rome. In 458, the Aquians had been causing Rome trouble, and one of the consuls for the year was sent with an army to deal with them. However, the fight was much rougher than it had been in the past, and the legions found themselves pinned down, unable to retreat, and facing annihilation. The citizens of Rome panicked, and, without dissent, a dictator was called for, and Cincinnatus was named. A delegation was sent to inform the old man, and famously found him at work on the small farm he had retired to, a living paradigm of Roman virtue. The delegation saluted Cincinnatus's dictator, imploring him to return to the city at once. The tribunes were appalled to see their old political enemy return to such a powerful position, but Cincinnatus was greeted in the city with such acclaim that there was little they could do but hope that the old patrician would not turn his absolute power against them. Cincinnatus, however, was not out to settle political grudges, well, not yet anyway, and promptly raised an army and marched to the rescue of the besieged legion. Wasting no time, Cincinnatus's army swept in and decisively beat the Aquians, saving the legion and ending the threat. He marched back to Rome and celebrated his well-earned triumph a mere 15 days after being named dictator. Before stepping down, though, Cincinnatus did clear up one bit of family business, forcing Virginius to plead guilty to perjury and go into exile. Rome safe and his family's honor restored, Cincinnatus resigned the dictatorship and returned to his farm, a hero in his own time and a legend thereafter. He would make one final appearance in the public record 20 years later, again appointed as dictator, though this time it was to deal with internal strife and not an external threat. Ironically, it was an attempt by a single man to capture total power in Rome that led to the reappointment of Cincinnatus as dictator. We will talk more next week about the plot of Maelius to make himself king, so for now I will just leave it that a conspiracy was in motion and Cincinnatus was brought in to deal with it, which he did as quickly as he dispatched the Aquians and again resigned the dictatorship and returned to his farm, this time for the last time. Cincinnatus is a bona fide legend, but the particulars of his life are almost certainly an invention. I look forward to the day when I begin covering events from the later, more accurate records, so I won't have to keep saying that the story I've just told you is largely fictitious, but we still have another 50 years before we get to the sack of Rome, so we'll just have to grind through this together. Anyway, the story of Cincinnatus is largely fictitious, but the man was a giant of his age and earned a little mythical embellishment. And regardless of its accuracy, the life of Cincinnatus was handed down from generation to generation and is still told today. His story had a great impact on the Enlightenment Age soldiers of the American Continental Army, who often referred to their great leader, General Washington, as the American Cincinnatus, because at the end of the war he retired rather than allow the people to make him king. When the army was demobilized, the retired officers formed a fraternity of sorts called the Society of the Cincinnati, membership in which was limited to men who had served in the army for 3 years. One of their members was later the territorial governor of Ohio, and he renamed a growing urban hub on the Ohio River Cincinnati, both in honor of the society itself and in honor of Washington, to whom the name originally referred. Ironically, the society still exists today, membership being limited to sons of the original members, making it a hereditary institution, completely anathema to everything the officers had originally been commissioned to fight. But I digress. Cincinnatus's mark had been set upon the world. But what do we make of him? Clearly he was a towering figure in the first century of the Republic, a hero, a consul, a twice-named dictator. But why the iconic veneration? Allegedly it is for the act of relinquishing absolute power, but we have already seen that Cincinnatus was not the first man to do this, nor would he be the last. The office of dictator was not created especially for him. It was, in fact, a constitutional role that was used regularly in times of crisis. His story, of course, had a nice ring to later Romans, who reveled in his simple homespun virtue, called from his field to save the city. In the good old days, they said, the greatest man of his age was found hard at work on a small farm, not eating figs on a sofa in some palatial estate. He was the epitome of the virtuous farmer-soldier, the ideal Roman. I think two things really contribute to the fame of Cincinnatus. The first is the incidental fact that most people, myself included before I began digging, believe Cincinnatus must have either been the first dictator of Rome or the only dictator of Rome to ever step down voluntarily, or something equally unprecedented. But of course there was nothing particularly unprecedented about Cincinnatus, and our veneration of him in that case would seem to be based upon nothing more than our own misconceptions about Roman history. But even though Cincinnatus wasn't the first or last of anything, he was unique in a profound way. The first two dictators, who, like Cincinnatus, served and then resigned, were men of a generation that remembered the Tarquins, remembered the tyranny, and would not think for a moment about seizing power for themselves so soon after they had thrown out the kings. Cincinnatus, on the other hand, comes from the next generation, a generation that lived their entire lives under the Republic, and was thus the first man who had no memory of monarchy to be given absolute power. The temptation to keep it would not this time be tempered by memories of subjugation and struggle. But the virtue of Cincinnatus returned to the people the power that was rightfully theirs. It was his resignation from dictatorship that really cemented the precedent for later Romans to relinquish dictatorial power and maintain the Republic, that thing of the people. In that case, Cincinnatus really does deserve all the praise he has given for selflessly handing the reins of power back to the people, where it would remain for hundreds of years. In any case, any man who voluntarily gives up absolute power is a hero whose story, rightfully, is told. Next week we will learn more about the machinations of Malleus, a scoundrel of the highest order, as well as the events that led up to the final confrontation with Veii, a struggle that broke the back of Etruscan dominance, which, though a victory for Rome, opened the door for the Gauls to sweep in from the north and hand the Romans their most devastating defeat, almost ending the empire before it had a chance to really begin. Welcome to the History of Rome. The years after the expulsion of the Decemvirate were hard. Old problems remained unsolved, while new ones threatened to tear the city apart. Patrician and plebe were at each other's throats over wealth, power, and land. The population of the city was growing, and there was not enough land to give them, and not enough food to feed them. Crop failures exacerbated the problem, and famine became a persistent killer. Bitter tensions led to a breakdown of military resolve, and old enemies long contained now returned a match for their former betters. The Volscians and Aquians both peeled off Roman territory to the east and south, and there was little the legions could do about it. This is how the Romans limped through the second half of the 400s BC, hungry, tired, weak, and demoralized. At the turn of the century, a final victory over VA would lift the hopes, albeit briefly, of the city, but for now, life was a dreary war of attrition. In the aftermath of the publication of the 12 Tables, the plebs immediately became aware of an institutionalized bias against them. They were incensed to see a codification of the ban against patrician plebe marriage and immediately opened a new front in their war for equality. The issue of greatest concern was access to the high offices of state. This meant the consulship and the religious offices of Pontifex Maximus and its subordinate priesthoods. Only patricians by law could hold these offices, and if plebs could not intermarry with patricians, then they would never gain access to the highest positions of authority or have the final say in law and religion. The plebs attacked this imbalance from two angles. First, they sought to legalize patrician plebe intermarriage, and second, they demanded that the consulship be open to plebe candidates. The former would be won quickly, and as to the latter, it would be just under 100 years before the first plebe was finally named consul in 366 BC. In 445, a tribune named Canulius introduced a bill legalizing patrician plebe marriage. The measure was fought by the patricians, who fretted about the dilution of pure patrician blood, but their resistance was only half-hearted. For one thing, their arguments really had no leg to stand on. When it came to officiating the necessary religious sacrifices, the Romans, all of them, believed that a patrician must be the official in charge, or the gods would be offended. Some patrician families claimed that mixing the two classes would inevitably offend the gods, but in Roman law, legal status followed the father's position alone, without any concept of genetic makeup. Incest, for example, did not even cover relations between maternal cousins. They were simply not considered part of the same family. So claims about blood dilution came off as absurd. Any child born to a patrician father was a patrician, period. Flimsy racial arguments aside, the matter basically came down to not wanting to share with the other children, and patrician solidarity soon cracked. There were a number of noble families who eyed the fortunes of the wealthy plebe families, and the measure was soon passed. As to admission into the consulship, the patricians fought much harder to prevent it, and far dirtier. This was not a toy that they were going to share with the other children. And so in 444 BC, right on the heels of plebes gaining at least nominal access to power, the consulship was suspended and the third manifestation of executive power was inaugurated, military tribunes with consular power. The switch was not permanent, though, and for the next 80-odd years, the executive leadership of Rome alternated between the new military tribunes and the traditional dual consulship, depending on the circumstances of a given year. Initially, three military tribunes would be elected by the centuriata and granted executive authority over the state, though over the years that number rose to four and then to six. The introduction of the new executive form can be seen as a move by the patricians to protect the consulship from plebe taint. No plebe could be consul if no consuls were elected. The military tribunes were elected democratically by the army, and plebes as well as patricians stood for in one election. This was fine with the patricians as long as the sanctity of the consulship itself was guarded. Further, by increasing the number of executives, plebe ambition was mollified, and at the same time power was watered down so that the elected plebes were not as singularly powerful as they would be if they had been consuls. Plus, the entire exercise kept plebes from agitating too hard for admission to the consulship. For the years between 444 and 367 BC, military tribunes were elected roughly half the time, the other years being governed by the traditional dual consuls. Much has gone into analyzing what factors determined whether consuls or tribunes would be elected for a given year, but by cross-referencing executive form with military activity, a possible answer emerges. Consuls were generally in charge during the major conflicts of the era, so it would seem that military tribunes were elected when no major military action was planned, whereas consuls were elected when engagement was imminent. This seems counterintuitive, given the name military tribune, but it makes sense. Plebes with consular power were acceptable to the patricians as long as they were destined for little more than off-year administrative duties. When real action was required, the patrician-controlled consulship was returned. The patricians wanted to make sure that they alone determined the course of state in times of crisis. If this is true, then the creation of military tribunes with consular power was little more than a stall tactic formulated by the patricians to put off full political equality with the plebes, which it did for the better part of 80 years. A second action by the patricians further removed the plebs from access to real power. One of the most important duties of the consuls was administering the census once every 5 years. The census determined citizen status as well as classification within the five-tiered system of the comitia centuriata. The consuls charged with taking the census had enormous latitude at the edges of the dividing lines to move citizens up or down, granting a degree of control over the end voting blocks of the centuriata. More than that even, it was during the census that citizen status was granted or revoked. Obviously, the patricians had a keen interest in maintaining control of the census, and when military tribunes were introduced, the administration of the census was peeled off from the other consular powers and invested into a new office that was destined to become one of the most coveted of all the magistracies, the censor. In time, the censor would acquire other duties, most famously the vague directive to protect public morals, but for now, the single role of administering the census was important enough. By senatorial decree, the censor had to be a patrician, ostensibly because of the religious ceremonies of the census that needed attending to, but most likely it was to make sure that plebs could never engineer more favorable voting blocks for themselves in the centuriata. These political reforms closed out the cycle initiated by Tarantulus in 462 BC when he first proposed the creation of the 12 table. The political and economic structure of Rome would not see significant alteration until the opening of the Samnite Wars in the mid-300s BC, not for lack of plebe agitation, but because the patricians seemed to have closed ranks and resisted any further reforms. As I said at the beginning, the years ahead were long and hard for Rome. Grain shortages were reported in a dozen of the next 50 years, with devastating famines following. The lack of nourishment inevitably led to plagues, which further decimated the population. Rome was forced to seek help from surrounding communities, north in Etruria and south in Magna Graecia and Sicily. Their requests, though, were denied as often as they were approved, and many of their neighbors reveled in Rome's misery after so many years of dominance. Just about every one of their enemies took advantage of Rome's depleted and malnourished army, and Rome's sphere of influence gradually began to erode. The Volscians and Aquians, once easily dispatched, now let their flocks graze in Roman fields uncontested. In the midst of this desperation, some men allowed their scruples to take a backseat to ambition, and one man in particular would pay the ultimate price for his hubris. A wealthy merchant named Manlius, who had never served in any important office but was of equestrian rank, began to dream bigger than his prudence should have allowed. In 439 BC, during a typical grain famine, official Roman envoys in Etruria rejected the Etruscan price for grain as gouging and returned to the city empty-handed. Manlius then went himself and agreed to pay the exorbitant cost, bringing home the grain the people needed and handing it out for free. Manlius was an overnight sensation, a newly minted political rock star. Everywhere he went, he was greeted by large ovations acclaiming his generosity. Manlius looked at the adoring masses and at his own personal fortune and let his imagination get away from him. He moved quickly from dream to action and began to actively conspire against the state with the intention of making himself king. The Republican government, he rationalized, had failed to protect and feed the people where he, Manlius, had succeeded. It was only right that he should rule. He began cashing weapons and bribing the plebe leadership to rise with him when he made his move against the Senate. But alas, it was not to be. The state controller of supplies, a man named Minucius, dealt daily with the same grain merchants who dealt with Manlius and soon learned about the plot. He went straight away to the Senate, who flew into a panic, recognizing their own unpopularity, coupled with the people's desperate state, might be enough to slip tyranny in the back door. The Senate needed a man whose fame and popularity outshone that of Manlius's to put a stop to the conspiracy. As I mentioned last week, they went back to Cincinnatus, now well over 80, and appointed him dictator once again. All of Manlius's careful planning was undone in a moment. Cincinnatus sent his master of horse to fetch Manlius and bring him forward for a trial. Manlius, knowing that he was in deep trouble, attempted to resist the summons, and when he did, the master of horse cut him down where he stood. There was a brief popular uproar over the murder, but Cincinnatus legitimized the act, saying that Manlius was being summoned merely for trial, and that it was his refusal to appear, not his alleged criminal activity, that sealed his fate. Political order was restored, and Cincinnatus again resigned. Soon after the death of Manlius, an external threat emerged that would eventually lead Rome into its final definitive clash with Veii. The city of Fidenae, an Etruscan outpost on the Roman side of the Tiber, which had been under Roman control for some time, decided to revolt and called for Vies' help. They figured that Rome, weak internally and caught up in the south with intrusive tribes, would be forced to let the city go, but Rome was determined to maintain control. Hostilities began with Fidenae, hoping to goad Rome into a battle she would lose, murdered four visiting Roman envoys. This treacherous act did lead to an immediate Roman response, but no conclusive action was achieved on either side. The war with Vies-backed Fidenae dragged on for years. To the Romans, victory was a necessity. If they lost control of Fidenae, trade up the Tiber River would be severely hampered, but despite the Romans' best efforts, Fidenae held out, and trade suffered accordingly. Through the 430s and 420s BC, Rome found itself militarily engaged on three fronts, in the north, east, and south, economically isolated and politically divided. It was not a good time to be a Roman. Some relief came around 425 BC, when the Romans finally won back control over Fidenae, but Vies itself still loomed on the horizon. The Romans, for the moment, dreaded a fight with their rival and did not follow up their recovery of Fidenae with action into Viate territory. A confrontation was brewing between the two powers. Their political and economic destinies were on a collision course, but for now a tense truce prevailed. Vies seemed to have been dealing with its own internal problems at the time, and so did not strike when the iron was hot, immediately at the end of a war which had drained Rome physically and emotionally. This gave the Romans a chance to catch their breath and consolidate their power. When the final clash with Vies finally erupted, the Romans were in a position to challenge their Etruscan rival on equal footing. The years leading up to the war with Vies were hard, but these decades would highlight the characteristic Roman obstinance that would win them an empire. The Romans simply did not give up. Beaten, harassed, tired, and divided, the Romans soldiered on. The Roman unwillingness to quit in the face of adversity bordered on the edge of insanity. They would accept catastrophic losses, but would never surrender. In the centuries that followed, Rome was many times beaten so badly that they should have relinquished their dreams of empire and retired to the dustbin of history. But instead, they buried the dead and raised a fresh army, never suing for peace and never retreating. It was this unwavering advance that so frightened Rome's enemies. In battle, legionaries would fall, but the line would keep marching incessantly forward, dispassionate, calm, and mechanical. There was no psyching out the legions or driving them to flight. They just kept coming. And if you decisively beat one Roman army, rather than surrendering like a civilized nation, the Romans raised another and set it against you, until more from exhaustion than anything else you were beaten and inexplicably found yourself under the yoke of a foe you thought you had beaten. This was the Roman way, and during these hard years it was on full display. It has often been said that of some generations much is asked, and of others much is given. Of this generation much was asked, and without even the promise of glory to soothe them. Their fights were not the great wars that made men famous. They were forced to deal with persistent skirmishes of attrition which cost lives and profited no one. The Romans of the Middle Imperium, which Gibbon famously called the safest, most civilized, and most comfortable generation in history, bears no resemblance to the thin, desperate Romans of the late 400s BC. But that future was secured by the sacrifice of these early suffering generations, of whom much was asked and nothing was given. I'll close tonight with a rare programming note. I am going on vacation, so there will be no new episode next week. But fear not, we will return in 2 weeks and trace the final conflict with Vies, Rome's very own Trojan War, complete with victory secured by sneak attack, and introduce a giant of the early Republic, Marcus Furius Camillus, known as the second founder of Rome. Until then, I want to thank all of you who have subscribed and supported the history of Rome since it began. It has been an immensely gratifying experience, and all of you out there listening have made it possible. Thank you, and I will see you in 2 weeks. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Last time, we left Rome on an upbeat, Fidenae recovered, and their position in the region stabilized. The Volscians were still a persistent menace to the south, but by this time they were clearly on the decline militarily. In another few decades, Rome would finally put an end to the Volscian threat and conquer them once and for all. But for now, periodic clashes continued to be a mainstay of legion activity. The main threat to Rome, though, lay north with the city-state of Veii, long an economic, political, and military rival. When not clashing with Veii directly, the Etruscan city had bankrolled Rome's enemies and fought by proxy. After years of avoiding conflict because they were stretched too thin, the Romans finally felt secure enough to challenge their northern rival openly and committed themselves to a war that would determine who controlled central Italy. As I mentioned earlier, Veii was the southernmost member of the Etruscan League, a loose confederation of 12 city-states that controlled Italy from the Tiber north to the Po Valley. Other members of the League included Tarquini, birthplace of Tarquinius Priscus, the fifth king of Rome, and Clausium, home of Lars Porsena, who either did or did not conquer Rome. Had there been any solidarity between the cities, it is doubtful Rome would have emerged triumphant from its war with Veii, but the League served an economic and cultural function rather than a political and military one. This failure to unite would ultimately spell the end for the Etruscans, who, in addition to pressure from Rome in the south, suddenly faced the threat of migrating Gauls, who were passing through the Alps into the Po Valley and squeezing the Etruscans out of land in the north. The third prong of the assault that would mark the end of Etruscan power was the ascendancy of Syracuse, the powerful Greek city in Sicily, who bottled up the Carthaginians, long an Etruscan economic and military ally, preventing any outside aid from reaching the besieged Etruscan cities. Syracuse had just put itself on the map by defeating an Athenian invasion force in 413 BC, and now ambitiously sought to control all mainland Italy. But, getting back to the topic at hand, the war between Rome and Veii was inevitable. Veii lay a mere 12 miles north of Rome, far too close for the two powers to coexist peacefully forever. Eventually, economic necessity drove them both to the conclusion that the other had to be eliminated. The region was simply not big enough for the both of them. There were three basic points of economic conflict that could not be resolved peacefully. The first was control of the lucrative salt beds at the mouth of the Tiber. Almost all the inland communities relied on the Tiber beds as their source of salt, and whoever controlled the source controlled a reliable cash cow. But the beds lay mostly on the north bank of the river, and so were controlled by Veii. The Romans looked on with envy and for years sought to dislodge the Veii, but were never in a position to do so. Now it seemed the time was ripe to make their move. The Romans wanted to control the beds, but Veii was not going to give them up without a fight. The salt trade was so important because of the economic conditions at the time, economic conditions that made the world too small for both powers. After the Etruscans had lost their foothold south of Rome to the Volscians, their direct connection to trade with Magna Graecia was severed. The archaeological record shows that the flood of trade Veii had once enjoyed as the gateway to Etruria now slowed to a trickle. Their overland trade routes closed, the Veii were forced to rely on seafaring traders, most importantly their Carthaginian allies, but after the rise of Syracuse, those Carthaginian traders began to be squeezed out, and Veii's economy suffered as a result. In better days, northbound trade was ample enough to be split between Veii and Rome, but now the limited supply was not enough to supply two economic centers. One had to be eliminated, or both would die. Finally, there was the basic issue of territory. Rome's population was expanding, but its territory was not. Veii controlled huge tracts of fertile land that all levels of Roman society coveted. The richest patrician and the poorest plebeian both saw the land north of the Tiber as the answer to their overpopulation crisis. The patricians wanted the land to relocate the landless plebes, who were agitating with escalating fervor to redistribute patrician land in a more equitable manner, and the plebes just wanted land, whatever the source. The need to control the salt markets, the need to control the sparse overland trade with Magna Graecia, and the need to control the land north of the Tiber finally drove the Romans to action, and around 400 BC, it was decided to take Veii out once and for all. The Veiites, equally in a bind, were more than willing to take up the fight, and the final conflict was joined. The war with Veii was unlike any the Romans had undertaken thus far, and the battle would change the nature and character of the Romans forever. Livy dates the conflict as taking place between 402 and 392 BC, and the archaeological record tends to back up this chronology, though not completely. The traditional length given for the war is 10 years, but most historians agree that this number was lifted from the mythical Trojan War, and that the actual conflict more likely lasted 6 or 7 years. Battles in the field were intermittent and inconclusive, leading the Romans to change tactics and besiege Veii itself rather than try and beat its army in the field. This forced the Romans to do something they had never before even contemplated, keeping an army in the field year-round. Traditionally, the campaign season lasted between April and October, with soldiers returning home for the winter. It was completely unprecedented to keep an army enrolled past October, but after the decision was made to lay siege to Veii, this is exactly what happened. The soldiers suffered this outrage only because the Senate introduced an innovation that would mark a turning point in Roman history, soldier pay. It was not a great sum, nor was it a permanent policy, but it set a precedent and marked the first step on the long road toward the establishment of a fully professional army, a road that led directly to the death of the Republic. For now, though, it was an expedient to keep an army in the field at a time when the soldiers had to return home to look after their farms. The pay alleviated the economic burden the soldiers faced and kept them fighting. The siege soon turned into a prolonged siege. The Romans wanted nothing more than a quick, decisive victory, but Veii was situated in a nearly impregnable position. Bounded on three sides by cliffs, only a narrow strip of land north of the city offered a level entrance. The Romans managed to gain control of that strip and cut Veii off from the rest of the world, but they were never able to do much more than that. The Veii were able to concentrate their total defensive capabilities on that one accessible point, and so the Romans were unable to make any headway. Though not far from home, again, Veii was only 12 miles from Rome, the soldiers were forced to remain in camp through the winter and began to grumble at the injustice of remaining in arms. The tribunes railed against the policy, claiming that the siege was a patrician policy dedicated more to getting influential plebs out of the city than actually winning the war. Look at Veii, they said. What army could possibly take it by force? It was absurd. Soldiers were kept on year after year, their farms falling into disrepair and their families falling into poverty, despite whatever pay was coming from the treasury, all in the name of a siege that showed no promise of being brought to a successful conclusion. A great many were sympathetic to this view, and the will of the army began to waver. Into this depressed state came one of the great heroes of Roman history, Marcus Furius Camillus. Of patrician descent, Camillus had been elected military tribune three times over the course of the war, distinguishing himself on the battlefield and running a notoriously disciplined ship. The Senate and the people were both increasingly dissatisfied with the military leadership, who seemed more willing to fight amongst themselves than unite behind a winning strategy. So, sick of the inconclusive bickering, they turned to Camillus, whose record spoke for itself, and elected him to the first of his unprecedented five dictatorships. Later crises would keep the Romans coming back to him again and again, and it was the reputation he established for himself at Veii that kept them coming back. What looked like a never-ending siege would be brought to completion within his six-month term of office. Camillus knew as well as anyone that a direct assault on the city was doomed to failure, so he set his mind on devising some other way to gain access. It did not take long for him to notice the Veiites' extensive sewer system and how easy it would be to breach the city from underneath. He set his army digging in shifts around the clock, making a tunnel from the Roman camp to one of the drainage pipes that ran under the city. He periodically ordered attacks on the walls to keep the Veiites busy, and they never caught on to the plan. It was now only a matter of time before the legions would come pouring in. Finally, the Romans reached the underground sewer system and followed it to the middle of the city. A raiding party was sent above, emerging from a temple and making straight away for the gates. Camillus ordered the bulk of his army in a frontal attack, which must have seemed like madness to the Veiites until the company of Romans appeared in their midst and opened the gates from within. The Romans did indeed come pouring in, and it was the end for Veii. Camillus and the Romans were not interested in terms of surrender or indemnities. They wanted to destroy Veii completely. The men were slaughtered and the women and children sold into slavery. The city was sacked and pillaged, with all its movable wealth finding a new home in the rucksack of some legionnaire. Prior to final victory, Camillus had made a fateful promise that one-tenth of the spoils of war would be dedicated to Apollo, but in the commotion of victory, his promise was forgotten and everything was piled into the baggage train undivided. The great Etruscan city of Veii had fallen, never to rise again. Upon returning to Rome, the victorious Camillus was awarded a well-earned triumph, though the procession would mark the beginning of his famous undoing and would soon find him exiled from the city he had just led to victory. Riding at the head of his army, Camillus was pulled on his chariot by four white horses, traditionally an honor reserved only for kings. The inhabitants of the city whispered to one another that Camillus fancied himself a monarch and began to look at him not as a conquering hero, but as a potential tyrant. His fate was sealed when, after the soldiers had returned home with their booty, Camillus began to worry about his unfulfilled promise to Apollo. Finally, he issued an order that all soldiers had to produce 1/10 of their treasure and hand it over to the state in order to appease the gods. The citizens were outraged, but complied out of their well-ingrained sense of religious obligation. They were further incensed when Camillus and the Senate announced that 1/10 of VA's land would also be set aside for Apollo. The land-starved masses could not believe their ears, and it was really only a matter of time before they lashed out at their erstwhile hero. A year or two passed, and a tribune finally brought charges against Camillus for mishandling the wealth taken from VA. Rather than face a hostile and humiliating trial, Camillus decided to leave the ungrateful Romans to their fate and went into voluntary exile. Legend has it that as he left, he offered a prayer that if he was innocent, that the gods should cause his former countrymen to regret his departure. A pure fabrication, but to the Romans, the sight of a massive barbarian invasion did indeed make them soon regret the absence of their best military commander. The victory over VA marked a turning point for Roman history, as well as Italian history as a whole. VA was one of the richest cities of Etruria, and its sack marked the beginning of the end of Etruscan dominance in northern Italy. In the north, Gauls from central Europe began to cross en masse into the Po Valley, sweeping through Etruscan defenses and settling in Etruscan lands. The Etruscans thus found themselves squeezed between the Gallic migration and the Roman expansion. As I said earlier, military and political solidarity might have helped them beat off the attacks, but the independent-minded Etruscans kept to themselves and so saw their cities fall one by one. It would not be a quick decline. Indeed, we will find them continuing to fight Rome throughout the Samnite Wars, but they would never again have the power or prestige they had so recently enjoyed. In the end, they would all fall under Rome's yoke and find themselves servants where they had once been masters. Although the push from the Gauls helped precipitate Etruscan decline, it also prevented the end from coming too quickly. The Romans, flush with victory, may well have continued to push north and defeat all the Etruscan cities one by one. However, a force of Gauls moved south through Etruria all the way to the gates of Rome, where they would decisively beat the Romans, handing them a defeat that would leave the city burned to the ground and its citizens debating not which Etruscan city they should attack next, but whether or not to abandon their ruined city completely. Next week, we will cover the sack of Rome and the return of Camillus, an event that would close a historical epoch, marking the end of the beginning for Rome. I'd like to start this week with a correction. In the episode Decades of Gloom, I told the story of a wealthy grain merchant who attempted to usurp Republican control and install himself as king. The grain merchant in question was not named Manlius, as I mistakenly said, but rather Malleus. We are about to meet a patrician named Manlius, who will soon find himself embroiled in a conspiracy to overthrow the government, but he bears no relation to the Malleus who tried to use a grain famine to his personal advantage in 439 BC. I regret the error. I would also like to say that those of you who are noticing an improvement in audio quality are not hallucinating. I have recently upgraded my recording equipment. My only concern about the switch is that my previous efforts will now seem poor cousins in comparison to these new episodes. Please do not hold it against those episodes. It is not their fault. They were merely the victims of inferior equipment. The Romans were riding high after their decisive triumph over VA. The defeat of their longtime Etruscan rival had left the Romans an economic powerhouse. They now controlled the lands north of the Tiber and began resettlement almost immediately.
The crops from the rich Etruscan soil promised an end to the cycle of grain famines that had plagued Rome for the last 50 years. They also became the hub of commerce in central Italy and took sole possession of the all-important salt trade, exponentially increasing Roman wealth. Things were looking good for the Romans, but fate was about to deal them a cruel blow. In an instant, they would crash down from the highest high to the lowest low and find themselves wandering aimlessly amidst the burned-out rubble of their city, wondering how the gods could have forsaken them so quickly and so completely. The barbarian sack of Rome would be one of the most traumatizing events in Roman history and leave the Romans in fearful awe of the Gauls until Julius Caesar finally exorcised their psychological demons 350 years later. Rome would survive, but just barely, and not without lasting damage. Now I say that the Gauls sacked Rome, but that is too broad a description. The label Gaul was a catch-all used by the Romans to describe numerous independent tribes who lived in and around the Alps. There was no sense of union between the Gallic tribes themselves, apart from occasional alliances, and for the most part, they fought as much amongst themselves as they did against any foreign race. The particular tribe that sacked Rome was called the Senones, and they were led by a strong warrior chieftain named Brennus. They had come over the Alps into the Po Valley in the previous century and settled along the Adriatic coast. This brought them into conflict with the Etruscans, who had previously controlled the land, and it was this conflict that brought the Senones into conflict with Rome. There is an official legend that explains Brennus' decision to leave the Adriatic and move south to attack Rome, as well as a modern interpretation that puts the attack in a wider geopolitical context of Italian realpolitik. The official legend is that Brennus attacked the Etruscan city of Clusium, who sent envoys to Rome desperately seeking assistance. The Romans were no great friend to Clusium, who had backed the hated King Tarquin in his bid to regain the throne 100 years before, but the Romans knew the Gauls were an enemy to be wary of, and so sent envoys to Clusium to take stock of the situation and report back how deeply Rome should involve itself. When they arrived, however, the Roman envoys immediately recognized the horde of barbarians as a real threat to all Italy and agreed to help Clusium right then and there. These envoys wound up leading Clusium's army against the Gauls, and in the fighting a Gallic chieftain was killed. Brennus took offense to this. He felt that the diplomatic nature of their mission precluded the envoys from taking part in hostilities. He sent his own envoys to Rome to demand retribution, but the Romans, in their infinite wisdom, decided that rather than handing the envoys over to Brennus, would elect the military tribunes for that year instead. At this further insult, Brennus ordered his people to march south, where he would teach the ill-mannered Romans a lesson. Modern historians doubt that such a minor incident would lead Brennus to suddenly move his tribe south and attack one of the most heavily fortified cities in Italy. They postulate, and there's some evidence to back it up, that Brennus had come to an agreement with Dionysius of Syracuse to tie the Romans up while Syracuse made their move to dominate Sicily. The Romans had historically been the allies of a Sicilian city called Messana, and Dionysius would have been eager to prevent Rome from sending troops in support of a city that he was trying to capture. Thus, an arrangement was made between Syracuse and the Gauls to attack Rome and keep them occupied while Dionysius made his move. This seems plausible, but we will never know for sure exactly why Brennus suddenly decided to march on Rome. We are not only unsure of why the Gauls attacked, but also when the attack actually took place. The confusion, again, is caused by the scarcity of accurate records prior to the event. Traditional Roman history records that the sack took place in 390 BC, though that date is derived from the often incomplete magisterial election rolls that later Romans used to calculate dates of past events. We will encounter this problem again when Livy makes the implausible claim that between 375 and 370 BC, no magistrates of any kind were elected. Livy explains this as being the result of a patrician plebe political deadlock, but most likely he was just trying to reconcile what the electoral roll said with what his own backwards chronology was telling him. Modern historians, cross-referencing with the more accurate Greek records, place the sack of Rome in 387 or 386 BC. So we are not entirely sure why the Gauls marched on Rome, nor entirely sure when they did so. But we do know who marched, the Senones, and we know where they marched, from the Adriatic coast to Rome, and we know how they got there, they walked, and we know what happened when they got there, they sacked Rome. and 4 out of 6 is not bad when you're talking about things that happened 2,500 years ago. The Romans were aware of the Gallic advance and enlisted one of the largest armies they had ever assembled to battle a single enemy, with plausible estimates ranging from anywhere from 12 to 25,000 men. They gathered at the Elia River, actually more of a brook than a river, and waited for the barbarians to appear on the horizon. When they did, the Romans were immediately on the fearful defensive. The Gauls were like nothing they had ever seen before. Huge and painted, bearded, with long hair, roaring all manner of crazy battle cries, the Gauls were a fearsome sight, and when they charged full speed directly at the Roman line, it did not take long before the Romans broke. The wings of the Roman army, composed of the lightly armed lower-class soldiers, were easily routed and fled for home, leaving the heavily armed center phalanx to be surrounded and massacred. It was the worst defeat the Romans had suffered to this point in their history, but their nightmare was only just beginning. In their haste to save themselves, the fleeing soldiers made directly for the fortified Capitol Hill citadel, leaving the walls of the city unguarded and the gates wide open. The remaining inhabitants of the city either fled outright or followed the soldiers into the citadel, giving free range of the city to the pursuing Gauls, who, incredulous at the lack of resistance and believing it to be some sort of trap, actually waited a full day before they were satisfied it was no trick and entered the city. An initial attempt to take the capital failed, so Brennus, rather than waste his manpower in pointless fighting, decided to settle in and starve the Romans out, meanwhile stripping the city of all its movable wealth. The siege of the capital began to be measured not in days or weeks, but in months, without any sign of the deadlock breaking. The besieged Romans grew more and more desperate as their supplies and morale ran out. The Gauls were faring no better. The hot Italian summer was not what the northern tribesmen were used to, and they began to drop like flies. Disease ran rampant, and Brennus saw his force dwindle daily in the foreign climate. It was a race to the bottom as both sides hoped to hold out one day longer than their equally beleaguered foe. At one point, the Romans were nearly defeated, but were saved at the last minute in dramatic fashion. A messenger had been sent from the capital to make contact with Camillus, their exiled hero, to plead with him to bring a force to lift the siege and save his former countrymen. The messenger scaled down an unguarded cliff, but the Gauls noticed the route and themselves attempted to scale the same cliff and break into the citadel. But famously, as they climbed, the sacred Capitoline geese, who the Romans had brought with them into the citadel, were roused and began to make a racket. The Romans, led by a patrician soldier named Manlius, were tipped off to the danger and drove the barbarians off the wall, preventing the only real attempt to take the Romans by force. Manlius, for his quick action and bravery, was lauded as a hero, but in a few years he would be executed for treason not far from the site of these heroics, a tragic victim of his own vanity. The siege stretched to 7 months, and both sides were at the breaking point. In their respective desperate straits, they both agreed to something neither would have considered at the start. The Romans would pay the Gauls to leave the city. Both considered this a dishonorable end to the fight, but the Romans had to get off the Capitol Hill, or they would all die, and Brennus, who wanted nothing more than to get out of the hot, diseased city, was now able to do so and still claim victory. The Romans agreed to pay the Gauls 1,000 pounds of gold, and scales were brought in to measure the amount. As the gold was being weighed, however, the Romans noticed that the scales had been tampered with, and the pounds were much heavier than they should have been. They complained, and in response, Brennus threw his sword onto the scales, further increasing the imbalance, and stating famously, "Woe to the conquered." The Romans stifled their objections and measured out the remaining gold, fuming but unable to do anything. The story of the sack of Rome, in reality, probably ended here, with the Gauls withdrawing north after being paid off. However, later Romans spread a thick coat of triumphant propaganda over the end of the story to save themselves the embarrassment of admitting to such a dishonorable conclusion, just as they added the story of Mucius Scaevola to the end of the war with Clusium, to avoid admitting that they had been beaten by Lars Porsena. In the Roman Hollywood ending, Camillus is reached and raises a force from the neighboring Latin tribes and marches on the city. He arrives just after the Gauls have been paid and, finding them sleeping off their triumph, attacks and beats the formerly invincible barbarian army, driving them out of Latium for good and recovering the Roman gold. Camillus then basks in the glow of Roman adulation as the screen fades to black and the credits roll. A nice story, but complete fiction. Regardless of whether Roman honor was saved at the last moment by miraculous intervention or not, the fact remained that the city was in ruins. At some point during the siege, a fire had started, and the city was gutted by an uncontrolled blaze. The surviving Romans, penniless and faced with the prospect of completely rebuilding their city, despaired that it was even possible, and began to speak of abandoning the Seven Hills altogether and moving en masse to Veii, where they could start afresh. Camillus strongly opposed this idea and gave an impassioned speech for the people to rebuild Rome and not flee in the face of adversity. To leave would be an admission of weakness and a moral failing. To stay would prove that Rome could never be defeated. The people, facing a choice between practical logistics and theoretical duty, remained unconvinced. But as the Senate was proceeding with the debate, a company of soldiers returning from guard duty stopped in the forum, and their commander ordered a halt, saying, "Well, we may as well stop here." The senators overheard this and, never ones to ignore a clear omen, immediately closed the debate and rejected all further proposals to abandon the city. Rebuilding would begin at once, no matter the cost or difficulty. Rome was here to stay. The history of Rome is bookended by barbarian sacks. It would be 850 years before another foreign invader stepped foot in the city. By then, Rome had risen, crested, declined, and was in the process of failing. Brennus's sack of Rome, on the other end, ushered in Rome's era of dominance. Until the sack, Rome was merely one among many in Italian politics, fighting and winning, but also dealing with setbacks and defeats. After the destruction of Rome, the Romans were reborn along with the physical city they lived in. It would be a more determined, more consciously imperial citizen body that would emerge in the 300s BC. The Romans would never again find themselves under the yoke of a foreign power, nor their walls breached by an invading force. When, in the 400s AD, the Visigoths and then the Vandals finally sacked the city, the level of despair was grossly inflated because the inviolability of the city had been taken for granted. Other cities changed hands, were occupied, or expelled occupiers. This was the natural ebb and flow of ancient politics. But Rome itself would be eternally free, granted special status by the gods. The Vandal sack, for all the physical damage it did, destroyed Rome psychologically, a blow from which it never recovered. And this sense of invincibility was born in the aftermath of the last barbarian sack, 850 years earlier. The Gallic victory humiliated, offended, and horrified the Romans who endured it, and they vowed to never let it happen again. They successfully kept their word for almost 1,000 years, a remarkable feat in the perilous and violent world of antiquity. Roman obstinacy, steadfast endurance, and unflinching resolve. A commitment to existence born out of near total destruction. From a practical standpoint, the sack also brings to an end the period of early Roman history about which we have no clear records or primary sources. Though all the previous records were lost in the fire, the Romans simply started again, leaving us a wealth of documentation that puts our understanding of their history on much firmer footing from this point on. I am thankful to say that the legend of Rome has finally ended, and the history of Rome has begun. Next week, the Romans begin the slow process of rebuilding. Their task was complicated by the fact that all their enemies, past and present, would attempt to take advantage of their weakened state. The Volscians and Aquians, of course, attacked, as always, but Latin allies revolted as well, and even some of Rome's own colonies decided the time was ripe to throw off the yoke of their mother city. But Camillus, not called the second founder of Rome for nothing, would lead the Romans to triumph and restore them on their inevitable path to glory. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. At the opening of the sixth book of his monumental History of Rome since its foundation, Livy wrote, "The history of the Romans from the foundation of the city to its capture, first under kings, then under consuls and dictators, decemviri and consular tribune, wars abroad and dissensions at home, I have set out in 5 books, covering matters which were obscure, both through their great antiquity, like objects dimly perceived in the far distance, and because in those days there were few written records, the only reliable means of preserving a memory of past events. A further reason was the loss of most of such accounts as were preserved in the commentaries of the pontiffs and other public and private records when the city was destroyed by fire. From now on, a clearer and more reliable account can be given of the city's civil and military history, after it made a second start, reborn, as it were, from its old roots with increased vigor and productivity. That seems like a good place to start this week. Rome was devastated. The city was in ruins, and the population, what remained of it anyway, despaired. Officially, the subject of abandoning Rome had been closed, but unofficially, the idea was still a potent force. Why rebuild when perfectly good homes sat vacant in a well-positioned, defensible city? The Romans had been merciless in their annihilation of the Veites, and the Etruscan city was practically a ghost town. But the Senate's mind was made up, and the Romans were ordered to rebuild, each according to their means. Camillus, whom the people now looked upon as twice their savior, if we believe the legends, stood firm behind staying in Rome, and the population, some reluctantly, followed their hero's lead. The new Rome that would grow out of the ashes of the Gallic sack would be recognizable today, with its haphazard streets and deep, tangled neighborhoods clearly devoid of any central planning. There was, in fact, no planning whatsoever. The Romans simply picked up what material they could salvage and began rebuilding wherever the whims of each individual directed. Rome, and I say this with love, is, and has been since the 380s BC, a convoluted mess that defies logic. The irony being that in almost every other town, city, or camp built by the Romans, rational right angles was the norm. A model was developed for the fortified military camp that centered around bisecting perpendicular roads that was copied in almost every other settlement the Romans established. A centurion encamped in Britain would have been able to easily navigate his way around a camp in Syria. Everywhere the Romans went, they took their standard grid city layout with them. But the Eternal City itself was the dark city of this Roman type A OCD. And the roots of that chaos lay in the years after the Gallic sack, when the Romans rebuilt quickly, but without any kind of master plan. Not that this is necessarily the Romans' fault. As they were attempting to rebuild their shattered city, nearly every one of their formerly subdued enemies took their shot at setting themselves free of the Roman hegemony. As I mentioned at the end of last week, the usual suspects, particularly the Volscians, reappeared, but longtime allies now rose up as well. Piling it on Rome became the fad du jour among long disgruntled Latin communities who never got over Rome's breaking up the Latin League 100 years earlier at the Battle of Lake Regillus. Even colonies set up by Rome with strong ties to the city joined in the rebellions and kicked their mother's city while she was down. While trying to put their lives back together, the Romans kept being recalled to arms, now to fight on this front, now to fight that enemy, now to fight this former friend. It is no wonder the city grew so haphazardly. There was barely enough time to nail down the roof before it was time to go and fight again. Throughout these years, Camillus was the rock behind which the insecure Romans hid. In times of danger, they turned to him again and again to lead them to victory. Whether he was appointed official dictator, as he was in 389, 368, and for the fifth and final time, 367 BC, or whether he was elected as one of the military tribunes for that year, Camillus was unquestionably the leader of Rome. Everyone relied upon his strategic and tactical brilliance to see them through these dark times. His enemies, and he did have a few, accused him of arrogance, of treating his fellow tribunes as if they were his vassals, not his equals. But the people were indifferent to these accusations. Camillus was their man. Plus, the other commanders did little to inspire the people's confidence. At one point, a tribune leading a legion against an allied army of Latins and Volscians saw his army flee in terror and hide behind their camp walls. Camillus was ordered to take command, and, by his very presence, instilled the soldiers with enough confidence to march back out and defeat the enemy they thought so powerful. Camillus dominated his time, and it would be another 150 years until anyone emerged to equal him in the pantheon of Roman heroes. That man, Scipio Africanus, who delivered the Romans from the scourge of Hannibal, is often mentioned in the same breath as Camillus, and indeed, the consensus opinion is that later historians, Plutarch and Livy especially, colored their descriptions of Camillus to make him seem a prelude to the great Scipio of Africa. But as Camillus remained in the people's high esteem, another hero fell from grace. Marcus Manlius Capitolinus, the last name attached in honor of his bravery during the Gallic siege, would soon find himself etched into Roman history not as a great hero, but as a villain. After the withdrawal of the Gauls, Manlius's ego was severely bruised by the honors heaped upon Camillus, and he took them as a personal insult. Had he and the others not held out against the Gauls, Camillus never would have had the opportunity to save them. Surely that deserved some glory, but Camillus hogged it all. Manlius was one of the few amongst the citizen body who could not stand the sight of Camillus, who he considered to be a pompous fraud. This aggravation led Manlius to break ranks with his fellow patricians and take up the cause of the plebs. By making himself their champion, Manlius hoped to do an end run around Camillus and earn the acclaim he felt he deserved. The most pressing issue of the day was debt relief. Obviously, as the Romans rebuilt, there was a hefty amount of borrowing going on, and the interest payments began to bankrupt the population. Every day saw men hauled off to prison for defaulting on loans. Men who had fought at Veii and stood firm against the Gauls were daily being made slaves by moneylenders who showed no mercy or compassion. Manlius spoke out publicly in favor of relief and often paid the debts of former soldiers out of his own pocket and offered interest-free loans to any who asked. The patricians were disturbed by Manlius's new image as the savior of the people, not only because they saw him as letting irresponsible debtors off the hook, but also because he constantly slipped in references to the great untapped strength of the populace and how their numerical superiority ought to count for something in the formation of policy. The patricians saw these as veiled and not so veiled threats against the established order and began to see Manlius as a revolutionary figure. Manlius was arrested once on charges of bringing false claims of theft against the moneylenders, but public outcry was so great that they were forced to release him. With peace abroad to allow for real public unrest, riots began to break out between patrician and plebe factions, Manlius offering daily harangues against the tyranny of the nobles and offering himself as the only patrician who cared about his fellow citizens. The implication was clear: throw out the Senate and elect a new democratic government with me as your leader. Finally, unable to take it anymore, the patricians again arrested Manlius, this time on charges of sedition and treason. The trial of Manlius would become famous for the way it would play out. The trial was originally held on the Campus Martius, which lay in the shadow of the Capitoline Hill. During his defense, Manlius was able to stretch his hand up to the hill and remind the people of his great service to the city, asking how anyone could possibly believe he was now engaged in treason. The argument was having its effect, so the savvy patricians adjourned the trial to a different location. Now, without the Capitoline as a backdrop, the charges and evidence against Manlius stood on their own merits. Public opinion turned against Manlius, who, it became obvious, was engaged in an active conspiracy to overthrow the Senate. The verdict was swift and harsh. He was to be thrown from the Tarpeian Rock, a steep cliff on the Capitoline Hill used for executions, ironically dying in disgrace a few feet from where he had achieved his greatest glory. The death of Manlius did nothing to end plebeian unrest, however. Manlius saw an opportunity and exploited it. He did not create the conditions for that opportunity. The plebs' overriding concern at this point were, as we have seen, debt relief, but the old standbys of land redistribution and access to political power rose again. The former problem was wrapped up in the latter two, and the plebs began to focus their energy on the land and power questions. Both the land taken from Veii in the north and the land taken from the Volscians in the south conspicuously wound up in the hands of a few patrician landowners rather than being divided up amongst the masses. How were the people supposed to pay off their debts when they were denied the income land provided? Further, how was it that state policy had granted so much to so few? Obviously, whatever concessions had been made to the plebs in the past had lost their potency. The plebs finally saw the office of military tribune with consular power for what it was, an attempt to water down plebe authority and deny them access to the consulship, the ultimate office of state. One man in particular, a patrician with two daughters, took it upon himself to end once and for all this unbalance. Marcus Fabius Ambustus, a patrician who enjoyed plebe support, had married his eldest daughter to an influential patrician and his youngest to a wealthy plebe named Gaius Licinius Polo. The younger daughter complained that she would never receive the honors her elder sister received on account of her husband's plebe status. Fabius, the story goes, promised his daughter she would have everything her sister had and began working with his son-in-law Licinius to break the patrician stranglehold on the consulship. They began by pointing out to people that despite plebe access to the office of military tribune, no plebe had been elected to said office for the last decade, which was true. They then demanded a permanent return to the dual consulship, with the stipulation that one of the consuls had to be a plebe. Licinius got himself elected tribune of the plebes, an office that had fallen into some disrepute, and used his veto power to bring government business to a standstill. He promised to veto everything in sight, including the yearly elections, until his demands were met. In addition to access to the consulship, Licinius also demanded that a cap be put on the total amount of land a man could own, as well as regulations on interest rates. It was this shutdown, engineered by Fabius and Licinius, that Livy uses to explain his chronological gap, stating that between 375 and 370 BC, no magisterial elections were held. Though the duration and excess of the standoff is no doubt exaggerated, the outcome is not. The plebes finally gained access to the consulship. The moment would not come without a final appearance of the great Camillus, however. The civil unrest and power vacuum led to calls for a dictator, and the Senate named Camillus, who enjoyed the support of everyone, patrician and plebe alike. They were hoping Camillus would see things their way, but much to their discomfort, he did not. Now, due to a flaw in the appointment ceremony, a religious event stuffed full with every kind of Roman superstition, Camillus was forced to resign for that year, granting a reprieve of sorts to the clearly defensive patricians. The next year, though, 367 BC, Camillus was again named dictator for the fifth and final time. He used his power to broker the deal Licinius and his colleagues demanded, and for the first time a plebe would be elected consul. The crisis settled, Camillus resigned. The old Roman leader died soon after, the victim of a plague that decimated the Romans in the 360s BC. With his death, a new era dawned. The Romans had survived their brush with death and emerged a strong, more democratic place. The honor of first plebe consul historically goes to Lucius Sextius, one of Licinius's colleagues who had helped engineer the shutdown. The land ownership ceiling and regulation of debt were granted at the same time, and, ironically, Licinius himself would be prosecuted years later for violating his own laws after he sought to accumulate large tracts of land for himself and his family. At this point, the law stated merely that one of the consuls could be a plebe. Later, around 342 BC, a law would be passed stating that one of the consuls had to be a plebe. For now, though, the plebes accepted the obvious victory and passed to the next generation the task of not simply allowing equal access to power, but guaranteeing it. The veracity of this patrician-plebe showdown and the election of a first plebeian consul in 367 BC has been called into question by modern historians. In the first place, they point out that Roman historians of the late Republic and early imperial period were obviously drawing their narrative from more recent events, specifically the conflicts that centered around the Gracchi brothers, who used their veto power to try and force through land redistribution in the 130s and 120s BC. Second, modern analysis has determined that as many as a third of the consuls prior to 367 were in fact of plebeian origin. As is so often the case, a clear dramatic delineation in history is less plausible than a gradual shift in policy over the years. There is no doubt that the vast majority of early consuls were patricians, but it is suspected that this was not the result of overt discrimination, but rather because of the greater wealth and fame of patrician candidates. The 367 BC date is important, though, because from that point on there is a marked increase in plebe consuls, demonstrating some sort of conscious decision to grant plebeians more power. And of course, the existence of a 342 BC law stipulating that one of the consuls had to be a plebe is not disputed, and it seems likely that this was the culmination of a decades-long shift rather than a bolt out of the blue. In general, what can be stated is that after the sack of Rome, the plebes demanded and received far greater power than they had enjoyed prior to the arrival of the Gauls. The Romans struggled in the years after the Gauls left them for dead, but managed to hold on in the face of massive external pressure and internal dissension. The new enfranchisement of the plebes made the Romans a more cohesive and less divisive society. This cohesion would be tested by a confrontation that loomed on the horizon. Though the Romans did not know it yet, they were about to begin a series of war that would leave them the dominant force, not just in Latium or central Italy, but in the entire peninsula. Next week, we will introduce the Samnites, the fiercest of all the hill tribes, who would not only prove more than a match for Rome, but also force the Romans to rethink everything they knew about warfare. The Romans would fight a single great war with three distinct phases against the Samnites between 343 and 295 BC. The Samnite Wars would pull all the major powers of Italy onto one side or the other and culminate with the largest battle ever fought on Italian soil. When it was over, the Roman victory was so complete that it would be 200 years before an Italian people again mounted a serious threat to Roman rule. And, by that time, Rome had grown into a global empire the Italians were not trying to topple, but rather gain full legal citizenship within.